Well, we're delighted this morning. First of all, we saw a lot of 11 o'clock people at the first two services, and I haven't a clue why that would be the case. But we're so thrilled you held point here at 11:15. We have Pastor Shawn Withy Allen speaking for us. And before we introduce him with a clip, because it is Super Bowl Sunday, you know, Shawn Withy Allen was a spiritual leader for the University of Hawaii football teams that were some of the finest in over its 100-year history, including the 1999 team that held the record for many, many years and being the greatest, held the record for the greatest turnaround in college football history, going winless into a bowl game and coached by our own Coach June Jones. You'll hear about him a little later. Then he parlayed that. He turned down a scholarship to Harvard University and other Division I schools to play for University of Hawaii. How many of you are alumni of not HU, but UH? Amen, amen, yes. Okay, how many of you actually graduated? No, that's okay, just joking. And so he went into professional football, indoor arena leagues, won championships, became an icon, an all-star player, including the Islanders team that was at the Blaisdell for a few years. But wouldn't you know it, football takes him from Hawaii to the West Coast to the East Coast. He lands at the home of the United States Special Forces in Fayetteville, North Carolina, a church of thousands led by a great leader, Michael Fletcher. And in this church, he enters the ministry, pastors, coaches, plays quarterback, and eventually finds an Asian woman, the only woman in Fayetteville, North Carolina, who's Asian. Marries her, they're here, we prayed over them earlier. And he told me one thing over the years, he'd come back yearly for vacation and we'd talk about what his future held, because he was on our staff at one time. And he says, the one thing I'll never do, I'll never plant a church. Well, today, we're 1 week away from him planting a combination of what we call Manna, Every Nation, and Grace Bible Pearlside. And so, never say never. Remember what they say, tell God your plans and he'll laugh. You know how to make God laugh? Tell him your plans. And tell him, in fact, what you'll never do, Shawn. But today is Super Bowl Sunday, and the background that gave him a platform, here's a little look at what you'll see when you pass through the pearly gates in heaven.
Bang, 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 bang. Boom, 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 boom. Bang, 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 bang. You knocked me out off of my feet. Boom, 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 boom. Ow, 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 ow.
Will you stand to your feet and welcome Pastor Shawn Withy Allen.
Thank you, Pastor Norman.
Okay, before he starts, though, on a count of three, one, two, three, go boom, all right? One, two, three, boom!
Wow, that was impressive.
That's pretty good. Okay, you may sit down.
That was impressive. Just as impressive. I don't know where you find these archived videos. I think a lot of that was from VHS. That's how far back that dates. Can't tell you how much of an honor it is to be here. As Pastor Roman said, I was on staff here before God sent me out to the mainland. It was really cool. I got saved through Every Nation campus. Well, before it was called that, it was called something else. But as a player at the University of Hawaii, through we had a ministry called Champions for Christ as a part of Every Nation, and went to a Pro Bowl outreach, grew up completely unchurched. My family kind of purposely kept us away from church. Grew up in Kailua, graduates of Kalaheo High School. So it shows you that, you know, Harvard was like, I went to Callahill. Why would I, you know? No. But a lot of people question my intelligence just for that decision alone. But I just, it's really cool because I got saved at UH, got connected here, was actually leading a campus of Grace Bible Church on campus at UH. We had a Sunday night service. I was a chaplain of the team. I had realized that God had given me a platform with football. And how many know all of us have a platform somehow, some way? God gives us something that he wants us to use for the sake of others, for the sake of him. And football was that for me. And so I went off to the graduate school of campus ministry with Pastor Billy Lyle, and we did that. And I never wanted to be a pastor. In fact, when I was in Fayetteville, I'll tell you in a second how I got there, but they asked me to get ordained. I said, hey, do you want to get ordained? I said, no, I don't want to get ordained. I don't want to be a pastor, man. I do this because I'm a Christian. I don't want to be a pastor. It's going to make me weird in the locker room. You know, like, I'm different now all of a sudden because I have this title. And you know, I didn't realize in the South it was a big deal to be ordained if you're going to be doing ministry at a high level. And so finally I said, okay, I'll do it. But I come from a family where, again, pastors were not looked up upon. They were looked down upon. They still call me the black sheep of the family because I went into ministry. And that's a running joke every time we have a family holiday. I love my family. They're wonderful people, but just, you know, really didn't see a need for God. And so when I came to faith, it was a pretty big event. And so here I was playing football, great platform with the Islanders, great platform with GBC and leading that service. Things were awesome. And then God just decided to put it on the owner's heart to pull the plug and cancel the team. And so I remember sitting down with Pastor Norman saying, what do I do? I mean, I really feel like God's called me to keep pursuing professional football, but I fired my agent like 6 months ago, and I don't really have any prospects right now. And he said, well, if it's the Lord. And sure enough, a door opened up, and I ended up in the National Indoor Football League and brought me out to Fayetteville, North Carolina. And there was a pastor there by the name of Michael Fletcher who knew of Norman and Sam Webb very well. And Pastor Jim LaFoon, you guys know Pastor Jim LaFoon, he comes here a lot. So that the church in Fayetteville, Manna Church, is the church where Jim LaFoon got started in ministry. And the senior pastor there was best friends with Pastor Jim. Now, I've known Pastor Jim since a few weeks after I got saved. He came in and prophesied over me and blew my world upside down, as he's done with many people. And so just ended up getting plugged in there and just thought I was there briefly. And then an opportunity came to jump on staff at a great church there. And just, again, praying about it because my heart was here. My heart's always been here. Growing up here, I've always had a heart for the islands, had a heart for the Pacific Rim. But I felt God calling me to the East Coast and didn't really want to go to the East Coast. So I sat down with Pastor Norman and Pastor Paris in hopes that they would tell me not to go out there. And sure enough, they said, look, I think you're supposed to go. And everything you get there, you're supposed to bring back here. And so that was 10 years ago. And so my wife and I got married. We flew Pastor Norman out to help facilitate, officiate the wedding and all this. And then about 1 year ago, serving out there, just, again, enjoying life. And Manna Church was right there at Fayetteville Fort Bragg, so we had a ton of active duty soldiers and military families, and we would lose about 1,400 people a year to military transfer. And so my pastor, really, he brought in the pastors and stuff, and he shared his vision. He says, I really think these next 10 years, the focus that God has for us is not here, but out there. And he said, I think we're called to plant churches at every stop along what we call the military highway. Basically go where the military keeps sending people because they always say, hey, is there a Manna Church there? And so that was the vision. And we already had the first two kind of lined up. He said, we're going to do one a year. And so me being me, I just kind of joked, well, hey, Oahu's got every installation there is right there on one island. And, you know, he goes, you should go. And I was like, darn, what did I just sign up for? And my wife was there in the room too. And she said, I don't think he was joking. I said, yeah, I know he wasn't. And so I said, we'll pray about it, and maybe 3 years down the road, we'll go. And then good old Pastor Jim LaFoon comes in 2 days later and calls me up in front of our entire staff. I run the internship, all of our interns, and he says, Shawn, I got a word for you. God says you've done well. You've been blessed here. I'm sending you out to go plant. I want you to go plant now. You're going to plant in 12 to 14 months, and literally prophesies me out of the church. I end up being the first guy to move this whole church planting movement, my wife and I, and here we are standing. So the first call I made right after that was to Pastor Norman. And I said, Pastor Norman, I don't know what's going on. This is what God is kind of doing right now. This is what our good friend Jim LaFoon felt inspired by the Holy Spirit to say, not knowing all the conversations that have happened behind closed doors. And I said, the only way we'll do this, my wife and I felt the only way we could do this is if it was a hybrid. We said, you and Michael co-married us. We want you to co-plant us. I said, we'll come to Hawaii and plant a church as long as basically we kind of stay connected with the Grace Bible family and it builds on this legacy. And so, sure enough, I don't know if any other pastor that I know of or in the nation would have the heart for the kingdom and the heart and the humility to understand that, yes, this is an awesome opportunity. So I just want to pause, and can we give thanks to Pastor Norman? Because we are here, and I am here in so many ways because of him. I have not made a big decision in my life without his counsel in the last 15 or 16 years, and I'm very, very grateful for that, very grateful for you guys. Now, with that said, I know it's Super Bowl Sunday, so we got to talk football a little bit, okay? How many Falcons fans we got in the house? Okay, so about half of one. All right, how many Patriots fans we got in the house? How many of you could care less about the Super Bowl and look forward to the commercials? Yes, that's why you're all here at 11:15, all right? Now I know. Okay, so we're going to talk less about football. No. Hilarious. I'm just excited. I get to watch the game in warmth. Last 10 years have been tough. I didn't realize how much of an island boy I was until I went to the mainland and froze my tail off. And it was like 50-something degrees, and people are mocking me and teasing me and all that. And I grew up in Kailua, so I'm spoiled, all right? We wore board shorts our entire life, maybe threw on a T-shirt to go to school. But all of life was lived outside, enjoying it, pretty flowers, pretty this and that. I so missed, having trees that actually have leaves on them year-round, having color around year-round, having grass year-round. I mean, those things you take for granted, I'll be honest. And so coming back here, I just take advantage of outside. And we moved back with my mom because even though we had a nice house and sold it and made some money on it, we couldn't even afford a car. Port here in Hawaii, so we're saving up to buy a house or at least rent something sometime soon. So we're living with mom now, and she's got this beautiful bush. I don't know what, I'm not a flower guy, but my wife says it's like a lily bush. There's these tall lilies that grow, and they're really pretty flowers. And I'd get out there, and I'm outside doing my Bible time or devotionals or whatever, eating, whatever I can do to be outside, I do. And I'd look over once in a while, and the bush was like smashed, just like matted down, flowers all just angled out, and like, what is going on with this bush? And so I've got three sons, 7, 5, and 3. So I figured, of course, man, one of these three little hooligans has been stomping on grandma's bush, and this needs to stop, okay? And so I pull them all in. Boys, what are we doing? This is grandma's house. We can't be messing with grandma's bush. And they're swearing up and down. They didn't do anything, and I don't believe them because I'm a good dad, you know? And so I'm just, it happens again. God, what is, and finally we realized there was like this coincidence. Every time we'd be gone and put the dogs out, the bush would end up getting smashed. And sure enough, the culprit was actually one of the dogs. My sister's big, huge chocolate lab, to be specific, kept laying on the bush because I guess it was cool. And so the flowers would get destroyed. And I'm just thinking to myself, and so I'm reading through Daniel, and I realize, man, this is so much like what each and every one of us face. Because we all live in a society where there's some pressure put on us if we're trying to live out our faith. And just like that bush could not handle the pressure of the weight of that dog, it's beautiful as long as that pressure is not put on it. Once that pressure gets put on it, the bush just is ugly. It's nasty to look at. And realize, man, so many of us in this world, so many of us in life today, and I've had so many conversations with people that say, man, it's so much harder now than ever and all this and that. And I just want to share a word today from the book of Daniel because I believe that, one, we're not in a unique point in history. It's been far worse many times before. And two, that the pressure doesn't have to destroy us. It can actually fuel us for what God has for us. Because I do believe every single one of us has a call from God that's planted deep inside of us that God desires to see bloom to its full potential. And so today, I just want to take a look at Daniel's life, and this message is titled Standing Tall in a Fall Down World. Because every single one of us, the moment you stand for something, the moment you stand for truth, the moment you stand for absolutes, the moment you stand for what the scripture considers righteous is the moment this pressure is going to come at you in one shape, one form, one way or another. And so I think God had this book written because what we're facing now is nothing new. And we see three specific examples here that I think all of us face at some point in life, if we're not facing them now, that we can draw from. And so my hope today is that you can leave this place, one, with the courage, but two, with also some practical tools to help you stand tall, whether it's at school, at work, in your family. Again, I come from a family where every family holiday becomes let's get drunk and try to talk Shawn out of his faith and all those kind of things. And so I've had to learn how to stand tall in the midst of pressure, as I'm sure many of you have. And so let's first start with Daniel chapter 1. We see this first pressure. This is the most common type of pressure, and it's the pressure that every single one of us faces, and it's a pressure that comes anytime you live in a world that isn't all about the honor and glory of God, which all of us live in, right? Unless you're in some kind of bubble, right? All of us live in a world and society that's not necessarily promoting the things of God. And so we have this pressure that comes through the enticement and the luring, the temptation of sin. Okay? And so I'll give you some background on Daniel chapter 1. King Nebuchadnezzar invades Jerusalem. In fact, the scripture actually says the Lord lets him invade Jerusalem because the people of God had walked away from God, so he had to wake them up. So Nebuchadnezzar invades Jerusalem, gets in there, carries off not just all their riches and all their things of worship, he literally carries off a lot of the young leaders as well, young men from the nobility, their top, the cream of the crop, the Kollel graduates, he pulls out and brings them to Babylon, all right? Yeah, you guys like that. What are you laughing for? So he gets them there, and he's going to basically reshape them into Babylonians, reshape them, reform them. So he's trying to get rid of their God, get rid of their culture, get rid of everything. And so what we see here is a response by Daniel here in verse 8. He says, "But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the royal rations of food and wine, so he asked the palace master to allow him not to defile himself. And now God allowed Daniel to receive favor and compassion from the palace master." Now, it's cool here that, one, even Daniel has a heart to still honor God. Because, I don't know, for me, if I witnessed my family probably get murdered, my entire hometown get decimated, the temple, which was supposed to be the most holy place on earth and the most powerful God ever, be ransacked and destroyed by heathens, I'd probably blame God, not worship God. You follow? I mean, what he witnessed and what he endured, we don't want to wish on anybody. And on top of that, it's believed that him and the guys that got carried off kind of, you know, got the snip, so their dream of having kids one day is now gone. Everything they held dear, everything they look forward to, all vision is now gone. And so where most of us would probably blame God, Daniel and his three friends, who we'll meet in a second, the one thing they do is hang on to God. They say there's one thing that cannot be taken from us, and that's the Lord. There's one thing that can never be taken. And I just want to encourage you guys right now, because maybe life is falling apart for you. In this moment, understand that whatever's being done to you, the one thing that can never be taken away is your relationship with God the Father through Jesus Christ. That has been purchased, that has been sealed, that is eternal. It can never be taken away. And so I think that's awesome. The second thing I think here is cool is that Daniel understood that he was in a place of vulnerability. He was in a place where he was no longer able to go to church on Sunday. He didn't have a church. He was no longer able to just kind of throw in Hillsong and worship and be built up in his spirit. That was now gone. He no longer had a pastor or a small group or anything. And so he realized, if I'm going to stand true for God, I've got to do something to make sure I don't get enticed by the lures and the temptations of the royal rations and the lifestyle that comes with being in the royal palace of this kind of filthy, immoral people. Does that make sense? And for all of us, we need to understand every single one of us has specific areas of vulnerability. All of us are vulnerable in areas where, you know what, even though it might not be biblically wrong to maybe be right here, if I'm wise, I'll build my borders back. And we see this where Daniel realized that if we start buying into the king's food and we start enjoying this lavish lifestyle, chances are we're going to be enticed to actually run from God rather than run to God. And so we see here his solution in verse 12. He says, "Please test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. And you can then compare our appearance with the appearance of the young men who eat the royal rations and deal with your servants according to what you observe." Now, he knew that the guy in charge of them, his head was on the line, because if these guys started getting sick, the king's going to blame him and probably take his head off. But he knows, okay, so there's a certain way God calls the people of God to eat. That's written out very clearly in the law. We kind of call today the kosher diet. And you guys familiar with the kosher diet? Now, is the kosher diet a strictly vegetarian diet? It's not, right? We see in Scripture that, you know, there's a lot of meat that's permitted to eat. And so why then would Daniel say, "Give us vegetables and water"? I mean, no offense to you vegetarians, all right? God bless you. I don't quite understand you, but God bless you. Super Bowl Sunday, man, I'm eating some meat today, all right? But why would he not say, "Let us eat what's lawful under our God"? Instead, he pulled that thing way back and said, "We're just going to stick to water and vegetables." And I believe the reason why is because he realized we need to kind of, instead of just standing where it's permissible, because we're in a place of vulnerability, we need to pull this thing back and stand back here and just only stick to waters and vegetables so we don't enjoy the food here. Because how many of you guys know the enjoyment of something leads to the enjoyment of another thing and another thing and another thing, and next thing you know, they're right back here. And so he recognized that, and that's the first key to resisting temptation, is understanding you're weak. That's why Paul says that when we are weak, then we are strong. So as a quarterback, I knew that if I'm going to fulfill the call of God in my life, there were some areas where I was vulnerable. And just so you know, usually you're most vulnerable in areas that you've fallen in the past. The enemy's easiest thing to do is to get you to fall that same place again. And so I grew up, again, unchurched, just living the ways of the world. So I did not grow up with a pure, holy lifestyle when it came to my interactions with females, okay? And as a quarterback, the opportunity for those interactions are bountiful. Do you guys follow me? For whatever reason, I don't know why, but for some reason there's a draw there. And so in college, I had to make a decision. I knew that I could easily fall in this area. And so even though there was nothing in the Bible that says you can't have a girlfriend, you can't kiss, you can't do this and that, obviously it's just no immorality, but I felt like in order for me to avoid the fall, I needed to kind of pull back my personal convictions because of the vulnerability of my heart. And so sure enough, I said, okay, I'm not going to date without a purpose. I'm not going to just kind of casually have late night talks and this and that with gals on the phone. I'm not going to ever be alone in a room with a female. There were certain personal convictions I laid out for myself so that I could be back in here. And those things served me very well moving on to a professional level, because at the professional level, it gets even worse, because now you've got all these beer companies and restaurants with, you know, near topless gals that all support the team because they want, you know, their clientele is all the young soldiers and folks that go to the games. And so you have all this, and of course they want the franchise quarterback at all their events and all their big post-game parties and all that. And I had to draw a line, and I said, look, I can't be there. What do you mean you can't be there? It's not, you know, you're just going to come hang out. It's like, look, God, I've made a personal decision. This is how I've chosen to live. Now, I knew the reason I couldn't be there is because if I walked back into that lifestyle, even just being around it would be very enticing to get me to fall into it. You guys follow me? And I knew that God was, you know, I saw what Scripture said about the power of what marriage can be and the power, and I knew coming from my background, man, I want what God has for me. I want God's best. I don't want God's, you know, just scraps. I want everything God has for me. And so met my wife, we started dating, and we brought people into the relationship. And by God's grace, one of the things we said to avoid kind of going down those previous paths was, we're not going to kiss on the lips until we get married. When the pastor says, you may now kiss your bride, that was going to be the first time that we kissed on the lips. There's nothing in the Bible that says you can't kiss on the lips. We just felt like in order for us to be able to actually live this out and get to the altar in purity, that was a step we had to take, because we knew that if that happened, it could very easily lead to other stuff happening. Because again, we can't necessarily control the desires of our flesh. If you learned how to control the desires of your flesh, let me know, because I'm still working on that, all right? I still got these boundaries, and by God's grace, we got to the altar, and Pastor Norman was there and said, you may now kiss your bride. This is the first time their lips are ever touching. And it wasn't because that's a biblical command. It was because it was a personal conviction that we had to lay back. Does that make sense? And what's really cool is that my last season professionally, I was on a bus ride home, and there was a couple guys, my longtime teammates, both of them had experience in the NFL and every brand of football, major college, all that, and they're just looking at me weird. And it's like middle of the night, because we're coming back from a game, and I just felt weird. Like, what are you guys doing looking at me weird? Like, I'm trying to sleep over here. And they're just like, we're just trying to figure you out, man. I'm like, I've known you for years. What do you mean you're trying to figure me out? I said, we've both had so many Christian teammates, but we've never seen anybody be able to withstand the ladies like you do. We've never seen one person never fall, and we've never seen you even come close to falling. How are you so strong? And in that moment, it hit me, because I've never felt strong. In fact, again, I've stayed where I've stayed because I'm weak. You guys follow? And that's when the Scripture hit me, and I said, what you guys ascribe to me as strength is because I acknowledge my weakness. And because I know I'm weak and I'm vulnerable in this area, I've set my boundary lines back here to prevent me from falling up there. And you guys see it as strength, whereas I see it as weakness. But in my weakness, therefore now I am strong. And whatever your area is, maybe it's a substance abuse issue, Maybe it's an anger issue. Maybe it's, you know, whatever it is. All of us have to be honest. And we can withstand temptation, all right? By the grace of God and a little bit of wisdom, we can withstand temptation. We don't have to go to the party. We don't have to go. And just know, when you stand up, there's going to be pressure coming against you. But my main point in all this is the result is that when you stand up for God, God stands up for you. God loves to honor those who honor him. Amen? So that's the first little pressure. The second one comes in the story of the fiery furnace out of Daniel chapter 3. And this is where some of us face it, some of us don't, but this is kind of that direct attack where we see Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, the other three that are in this, main characters in this book. So they have a heart, just like Daniel, to stand for God, and the king erects this huge golden statue, and he says, we're going to play some music. At the sound of the music, every single person in Babylon must bow down and worship this thing, and if you don't, we're going to throw you into a fiery furnace, and you're going to suffer a slow, painful death. That's some direct pressure, is it not? That's your boss saying you're going to violate your religious beliefs or you're going to get fired. That's the equivalent of that in our country. And so here they are facing this pressure, and I love their response here, beginning in, where am I at, verse 15, or verse 16. They say, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to present a defense to you in this matter. If our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the furnace of blazing fire and out of your hand, O king, let him deliver us. But even if he doesn't, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods and we will not worship the golden statue which you have set up. Now I love, one, notice the attitude in both of these. They're not on Facebook blasting people, angry. They're not standing up shouting, shaking fists, you're going to hell, you heathen. You know, they are respectfully standing on the truth of what God says. Amen? They're extending grace. They're being respectful. They're being honoring, but they're not budging at all. And what I love here, and the point I want to make, is that most of us, if we're honest with ourselves, we have an only-if faith. What I mean by that is we serve God only if it's convenient for us, only if things are working out for us, only if everything makes sense for us. But the moment things stop making sense, the moment things stop working out, the moment things that I want to happen don't happen, all of a sudden I start questioning God and trying to make things happen myself. So rather than continuing to stand strong and trusting in God, I say, okay, God, you must not be concerned here. Let me go work this out myself. You follow me? Whereas here we see these three, they said, even if, because they knew God could deliver them, they said, look, our God, if he wants to, he'll deliver us. He has the capability to do that. But even if he doesn't, we will not bow down to your gods. We will not serve your gods. We will not flee from the one we know is true. So if that means we die in that furnace, then we die in that furnace, knowing that God is fully capable of delivering us, but for whatever reason he chose not to. Therefore, we know he is only good. He only has our best intentions in mind, and so it must have been best for us to burn in that furnace. Even if nothing happens, even if he doesn't deliver us, I'm going to stand firm. And that's the attitude I would love to see us have in this day and age. Even if things don't work out, because that's true faith. That's where your faith gets put to the test. But let me tell you this, a faith that is tested is a faith that can be trusted. The moment you stand tall, because we're going to see here, in fact, I'll go over the results in a second, because this is what's awesome, is that they're in the midst of this very chaotic, very ungodly culture. They're faced with this direct pressure, but look what happens here. They get thrown into the furnace, and then in verse 24 of chapter 3, the king is astonished, gets up. He said to his counselors, was it not three men that we threw bound into the fire? They said, yes, true, O king. He replies, but I see four men unbound walking in the middle of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the fourth has the appearance of a god. Scholars believe that this was actually the pre-incarnate Christ who shows up in this moment in the middle of that fire. And wouldn't you know it, but the very thing that was designed to crush them, to destroy them, to just, you know, all that is the very thing that God uses to set them free. Not only are they not being burned up by the fire, they're unbound, walking around freely, doing what is physically impossible for human beings. Because here's the point. When you stand up for God, God stands up with you. He never has us fight our battles by ourselves. He never has us all alone. He's always standing up there with us saying, let's build this faith. Let's build this faith. Let's build a faith that you can trust in. Because he knows that this is not the only battle we're ever going to face, but he develops us, he builds us, he moves us so we can move into the next season. And I promise you, as you stand tall against this direct pressure, I promise you, you're going to see things happen around you and in people around you that are going to be pushed forward. I remember I was coaching, I broke my arm my first season in Fayetteville, and so they made me the offensive coordinator. They wanted to keep me around, and I was kind of a QBOC anyway. And so I was faced with a dilemma when our head coach got suspended for a game. He got kind of crazy the game before, got suspended. And so we had a big game, and in our arena, there was a bunch of offices at the top for the business side of it, and there was a window up there. I guess they found an office where he could sit and still see the field, because he wasn't allowed to be in the stadium. That was part of the suspension. And so the general manager comes and finds me underneath the stadium before the kickoff, and he says, here's a radio. The head coach is in an office up there. He's going to communicate with you. Nobody knows it. It's completely clear. And he just walks away. And I'm thinking to myself, whoa, what's going on here? And of course, the temptation to just kind of bow to that and do what anybody else would do is there. But then I was like, I can't do this. I can't violate my integrity. I can't be a man of God and just sit here and do what I know is wrong. And so I go back to the general manager. I said, hey, you know, I said, Bobby, come here, man. I said, I can't do this. He passes back. He says, you don't have a choice. I'm not asking you to do this. I'm telling you to do this. I said, well, I'm just telling you I can't do this. He says, well, if you want to be a part of this organization, you will do this. Again, you don't have a choice here. And so right then in my mind, I'm thinking to myself, okay, well, I can either lose my career or I can lose my integrity and violate my conscience. And I can just, let me just tell you right now, one thing I've learned, there is nothing more powerful in life than a clean conscience. I encourage you, do everything you possibly can to keep a clean conscience. There's nothing more powerful in life than that. And I thankfully had a mentor who had drilled that into me. And so I said, look, I said, sir, here's the play sheet, here's this radio, you go ahead and call the plays because I will not violate my integrity. He says, nobody's going to see. I said, God sees everything I do. The God I serve sees everything I do, and even if only he knows, that's enough. I cannot do this. Have fun. Have a great season. I've got to move on. And he looked at me, looked down, took the radio, gave me the play sheet, said, you know, use some expletives, said, whatever, go coach the effing game, you know. And that was that. And what was awesome, I thought I was going to get fired after the game maybe. What was very cool was, well, thankfully we won the game, so that was cool because God stood with me. That helped a lot. But the second thing was I never once again had to have that issue. And never again. That was the first season I was there. That was a pivotal moment. From the rest of my career, the next 6-7 years, I never once had any kind of even invitation to where I'd be tempted to violate my conscience. A lot of conversations, because there's a shady side of professional sports, a shady side of professional football, business deals and all that. And, you know, I was the franchise quarterback, so of course they wanted me in on everything. Those conversations started, they never even brought me into the room because they knew what I would say, they knew the stand I would take. And I didn't yell, I didn't scream, I didn't get angry, I just simply stood my ground and said, even if it cost me my career, but sure enough, God stood with me, and that head coach actually no longer, he was gone after the season. We stepped in, had a great career there, but I credit it to that moment, having the willingness to stand tall. Was it scary? Absolutely. Was I very, very, very tempted to not stand up and bow down? Absolutely. But by the grace of God and the fact that I had resolved to live in a certain way, he gave me the ability to stand tall in the midst of that pressure. And the last one here is the lion's den. Daniel in the lion's den, one of the stories you hear as a kid, and you know, if you grew up in church, and we see here this third pressure. We've got temptation, you've got kind of that direct attack. This third one is probably the most painful one. That's when people attack you. People attack you because you're standing up. People attack you because when you stand up for God, favor and prosperity tends to follow. That's the pattern we see in Scripture. And when you stand up for God, I was told early on by a mentor, he said, hey, for every one person that encourages you to fulfill the potential God has for you, there's going to be 9 more that try to tear you down. Because the moment you stand up for something, and they said the worst ones are the compromising Christians, the ones who will go to church with you and stab you in the back when you're not there because they feel bad because you're living the way they want to live but refuse to live. and they want to tear you back down so they can feel better about themselves. And if that's you in this area, I'm not trying to make you feel bad, but I would encourage you, hey, get before God today. Scripture says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Resolve today to say, Lord, I may have compromised in the past, but today I want to stand tall in this fall-down world. It's as simple as that. Repentance, all right? And then get around some guys or gals that can help you walk this out. Don't hang around people that are going to try to tear you down to that level. Hang around people that are going to help you get to where God's called you to be. And so we see Daniel here. He's become really excellent. He gets promoted above everybody else. And so his peers are jealous, and they devise a scheme to tear him down. And so they even manipulate the king himself, because the king loves Daniel, because Daniel's bringing a lot of money for the empire, you know. So the king loves him some Daniel. And they get the king to sign it to a point where he can't even change the law. He can't even save Daniel. And so sure enough, they basically sign a law that says you can only worship the God that the king says to worship. So Daniel can't worship his God anymore. And if you get caught worshiping God other than that God, you're going to be thrown into a den of lions and eaten to death. And so I love Daniel's response to this. You could tell he's super intimidated, because in verse 10 of chapter 6, it says, although Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he continued to go to his house and to get down on his knees 3 times a day to pray to his God and praise him, just as he had done previously. Daniel was so intimidated that he went back and did the very thing he does every day. He says, God, I'm going to worship you. I'm going to pray to you. I'm going to stay connected to you. And he gets arrested, gets thrown in the lion's den. The king tries to save him but can't. Long story short, he doesn't get touched at all. And the reason I bring this up is because a lot of us will have times in life where the people around us are the ones that are actually attacking us. The people around us are the ones and the pressure is to respond and retaliate, to get vengeance, to make things right, to do all these things. But as you read this story, I don't have time to read it all, but as you read this story, I'd encourage you to read it. Notice how Daniel never once, again, he doesn't take it personally. He doesn't go crazy. He respects the king, honors the king. He realizes that people are not the problem, okay? It's the enticement behind the people. It's the sin in the people. And so he knows that he can put his trust and keep his trust in the everlasting true God to stand there in that moment and avoid all of this unforgiveness issues and all this stuff. And what we see again, the result, anytime people attack you, you choose to stand with God, God will always vindicate you. And what's cool is that at the end of it, the lions don't eat him. The king runs to him. The king was fasting for him. I mean, that's how influential this guy had become. And the king makes an edict to go out through all the empire to say, Daniel's God whom he served is God. So here we have these guys that completely turned this ungodly empire upside down because they simply stood tall in the face of various forms of pressure. What would happen if we, all of us in this room and all of us in the services that we've spoken to, if we would simply have this same resolve to stand tall, to let our faith get tested so we could have a trustworthy faith? And so I'm going to close with 3 very, very short little points here about how to develop this kind of ability to stand tall. And really, it's determined by the content of your character. The content of your character will determine your ability to stand tall in this fall down world. And the 3 keys to this, I say the first one is consistency. Some of you guys are like, uh-oh, man, I don't have character. I've always tried. Consistency is the first piece of building this character. Because here's the deal. When I mean consistency, Daniel prayed 3 times a day, right? Every day, 3 times a day, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 60, I mean, as long as he lived, Daniel consistently spent time with God. And here's my point. None of us have the willpower to personally generate the character we desire. If left to ourselves, we will always fall short. The only way we develop this character is by interacting with God himself through his word. The word says it's alive, it's active, it's living, it's like a mirror. My wife loves to point out anytime I have anything in my teeth or on my face, she is my mirror to keep me from embarrassing myself in public, right? She makes sure I don't dress too stupidly. Had some shoes on, she's like, no, we're not wearing those. What do you mean? She's like, yeah. She even told me, you need to text so-and-so because he's got a little better dress than you do. I'm like, what? You know, and she's my mirror, right? I'd be a fool not to have her point that out and then make the necessary adjustments. If I have a booger in my nose, I want somebody to tell me, they're my mirror, I'm going to take it out, right? Rather than walk around like, hey guys, and you're just disgusted. The word is a mirror. It shows us who we are. It shows us where we don't measure up. But unlike where a lot of us think, well, okay, well, so I don't measure up there, so now I've got to work harder to do that. The scripture actually says we need to embrace it, ask God to change us, invite us into that area, and now all of a sudden he begins to change us. So the consistency with God is the first piece of this stand-up character. He's the one that formulates character. So my only part is to make sure that I actually make a plan to get in his presence on a consistent basis. All right? Number two is courage. The moment you choose to be consistent, the moment you choose to stand tall, remember, people are going to try to tear you down. You're going to face situations that are going to require courage. And courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is not like, oh, I'm a superhero now, I can do whatever. No, courage is, I am very afraid, but I'm still going to do the right thing anyway. That is courage. And that's what God told Joshua three times in 9 verses in Joshua chapter 1 when he said, I want you to go lead the people in the promised land. Be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. Know that I'm with you. Know that I'm with you. God calls us to be a people of courage. And if we're going to stand tall, we need to embrace that and say, you know what? Even when I'm afraid, I will still do the right thing. Amen? I'd much rather be remembered for standing up than forgotten for blending in. And I'm sure you guys all, a lot of you feel the same way. And the last one here is no compromise. Pre-decide what you're going to do. Pre-decide. Before you get to the point of vulnerability and temptation, make a decision ahead of time of who you are, who you aren't, what I will do, what I won't do. So when you know that Susie and James are going to be by the water cooler tomorrow talking gossip about everybody, pre-decide that you're not going to join that conversation. And when they try to entice you to come in because all of a sudden it pertains to you as well, they've been talking about you, you probably want to know about this. Pre-decide, right? When your friends are going somewhere you know you probably shouldn't go, pre-decide, this is not who I am anymore. This is not what I'm going to participate in. It takes that no-compromise attitude to say, you know what, before I face the pressure, I'm going to make a decision to avoid the pressure. And all of a sudden, when it comes to you, because sometimes you can't avoid it, when it comes to you, you have such a greater capacity to handle it. Amen? And so I want to see us bloom into all God calls us to. So don't be afraid of the pressure that comes. Don't fear it. Embrace it. Because like I said, a faith that is tested is a faith that can be trusted. And there's nothing greater than faith in this world. Amen? Why don't you bow your heads? Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you so much for just this opportunity. Thank you for allowing me to share this word. And Lord, I trust right now that you are stirring up every heart in this room. Various things. We're all in different places in life. We're all coming from different areas, God. And I thank you, Lord, that for every one of us, Lord, you've called us to stand up wherever we are. And so I pray that you would make this word applicable to every person's situation right now, regardless of age or socioeconomic status or marital status, Lord, wherever we are, Holy Spirit, we invite you in right now. Let us not leave this place the same way we were when we came in. I pray that grace would abound, Lord. I pray that you would remove any sense of condemnation, Lord, that you would just bring in the reality that there is forgiveness and healing in you, Jesus. And with that said, keep your heads bowed. I want to do one more prayer. If you're here, the one stipulation to this stand-up is having a relationship with God. It's knowing that Jesus has already stood up for you, so there's nothing anybody can do to tear you down. That your faith, once you place it in him, your faith has been tested, it has been tried, and it has been proven true. Sin separated us from God, but Jesus came to this earth, died on that cross to restore the ability to have that relationship. Like I said before, there's no condemnation. There's nothing you can do or could have done that takes you out of that place of grace. It's simply a decision we make. And if you've never made that decision or you've strayed away from that decision, you want to say today, I want to renew my commitment to Christ, I'm not going to ask you to do anything but simply put your hand on your heart. Because I'm going to say a prayer and I want you to follow along with me under your breath. Just put your hand over your heart because that's where we're going to ask Jesus to come in. Jesus, I thank you that you died for me. I thank you and I acknowledge I need you to save me. I am a sinner in need of a Savior. And I know that you are the only one who can save. And so, Lord, I come to you right now. I humble myself. I acknowledge that I need you. I invite you into my heart. I receive your forgiveness. I thank you for extending grace to me. I ask you to fill me up right now with your love, with your power, that I may walk out all you have for me. Bring me back into your family in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can we give a hand to those who prayed that prayer? Amen.